Welcome back to the WDSU News Hot Seat. I'm Norman Robinson. Tonight's focus is on race relations in the aftermath of the Paula Deen fiasco and the recent Supreme Court ruling striking down Section 4 of the Voting Rights Act. And there's no one better to talk about that than former mayor and current head of the National Urban League, Marc Morial. Again, thank you for being here. Can we move forward? You say we have made progress, but it appears in some quarters we're going backwards in terms of the divisiveness that exists among certain segments of the American community when it comes to racial
issues. We're going to continue to struggle with this, I think, to a great extent, because now America is a nation of whites and blacks and Latinos and Asians and people who are American Indian. The nation's changing dynamic means that we're going to continue to struggle with this issue. But what I urge people to do is think about the basic principle. The basic principle is liberty, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for all people, and creating a fabric. It's a balance between our responsibility as a community and our responsibility as individuals. It's not one or the other, and we have to continue to recognize that at the end of the day, if you can get the economic opportunity quotient correct, if you can get the educational quotient correct, it does a great deal to create a better nation and a better America and an America which can move beyond its past.
And yet we have seemingly a growing chasm between the haves and have-nots along the racial line when it comes to employment and job opportunity.
It's gotten worse since the aftermath of the recession. And this is what's important, is that since the recession receded, the wealth gap, the chasm between those who have and those who have not, regardless of race, has gotten wider. If you add race as a factor, it's a even deeper chasm. And yet we don't hear enough about our elected officials and our business leaders talking about why, if we can close that gap, it's going to strengthen economic growth. There seems to be a tendency that we've fallen into a trap that believes that it is one versus the other, versus growth at the bottom and growth in the middle creates growth for all.
There's a double jeopardy in the African American community, specifically as it relates to African American males. You have the higher unemployment, and you also have the higher risk of violence and death as a result of violence. What is the solution, in your opinion?
You know, I long believed, and you know, Norman, we made great progress in the 1990s in reducing violence when I was privileged to lead the city. We did it with a formula which included intelligent community policing and the right-sized police department that used intelligent procedures. We also combined it with a dogged, determined investment strategy in young people, employment, workforce, job training. I also worked very hard to try to create greater economic opportunity for businesses who were small, owned by people from communities of color. We had a formula. It cut the unemployment rate in half. The poverty rate was reduced. The participation levels increased. It was helped by a growing national economy. This is what I'll say to people. This is beyond a political or an economic issue. It's a moral issue. We can't countenance.
And you underscore moral.
I underscore moral because no nation, no great nation, no prosperous nation should tolerate any group of people being so locked out and left out the mainstream of our economy. But let's say this about black men, right? We have a tale of two communities, because there are highly successful African American men like yourself, like myself, like any number of political, business, civic, and religious leaders that we all know. Yet we have too many young black males locked out and left out, and we have, I think, to some extent, a lot of rhetoric. We have some action by some, but not enough to recognize that this is a problem. Look, let's just look at the criminal justice situation and the large numbers of people going to jail, importantly, for nonviolent offenses, for long sentences or sentences which are too long, which cost us money, which rob those people of any chance to mainstream themselves once they get out. So we have some challenges in this country when it comes to this, and I applaud anyone who's out there listening who says we're doing something, elevated, help do more of it. But this is a moral issue for this nation.
Let's talk about the criminal justice system locally.
Mm-hmm.
As one of the historic figures of this city, what advice would you give to your two friends, the current mayor and the current sheriff, who are now both engaged in a bitter feud over funding prison reform?
The feud is absolutely, as I've observed, counterproductive. I think they ought to call a moratorium on the litigation. I think the two of them should get together, and I think the two of them should find both consent decrees, in my opinion, are in the best interest of the city. I think the longer you delay the implementation of the police consent decree, it is counterproductive to a sustainable reform plan for the police department. As long as you delay the criminal justice system or the jail consent decree, it has the same effect. Both consent decrees are in the best interest of the people of this city and should have been implemented long ago. Now, people say it costs us money. I just read a piece in the paper where certain leaders in this city are seeking $12 million a year to better advertise the city for tourism purposes. That's an important objective. The question is, where is the priority? I can say categorically, a stronger, better police department that respects its citizens, that has high quality, well-trained, well-paid personnel will make this city better. I can also say that a first-class prison system, whether you agree with the jailing of people or not for this offense or that offense, is in the best interest of the city. So I think that the feud has been counterproductive. I'm candidly surprised at it. Because both Mitch and Marlon have been longtime friends, longtime political allies, and I think that they've confused their own supporters by carrying on a feud that is costing both of them large dollars when it comes to lawyers, a whole lot of political capital when it comes to public feuding. They need to get together. They need to resolve
it. How much is it costing the city image-wise?
I think the image is short-run. The issue really is long run. The longer you delay coming up with a permanent, transparent plan to fix the New Orleans Police Department, that damages the city in the long run. Same thing with the jail consent decree. I know that they cost money. A generation ago, Norman, we had to find new money to increase police pay in this town. We had to find new money to expand the recreation department. It was difficult. It was hard. If it's a priority, it can be done. It should be done. I hope that these two both highly talented leaders would get together and resolve this issue quickly and do it amongst themselves.
In your opinion, it's in the best interest of the city?
It's in the best interest of the city. We're not talking about the politics of the mayor, the politics of the sheriff. We're talking about what's best for the people of New Orleans and the people of the region.
Last question. You were part of the anti-apartheid movement to divest ties with South Africa. You saw Nelson Mandela walk out of prison. What does a man whose personality and whose contribution to the world, as colossal as it is, what does it mean to you?
You know, Nelson Mandela is a figure who will stand with Washington, Lincoln, Winston Churchill, Gandhi, as one of those iconic leadership figures who'll be studied and admired for centuries to come because of his journey from jail to become the leader of a free South Africa. What's remarkable to me about Nelson Mandela is that notwithstanding the political persecution he endured, the jailing he endured, he emerged with little bitterness. He emerged with a strong commitment to the multiracial democracy that South Africa has sought to be, and with being the kind of revered international figure. In our life, Norman, I don't think there's a singular figure whose impact, whose life, whose contributions exceed those of Nelson Mandela.
Marc Morial.
Thank you.
It's always interesting having a conversation with you.
Always, Norman.
All right.
Thank you.
Care.
My pleasure. Good friend. Thanks.
Oh, that's all the time we have, and thanks to my guest. And, of course, as always, thanks to you for watching. Now let's head back over to the news.